Tonight's mailbag is lubricated by White Chocolate Stout by Spectrum Brewing from BC. When I chose a stout, this is not the beer that I was expecting to see come out of the can. We'll just have to see what it tastes like. That is extremely sweet. That's not at all what I was expecting. So, to the opening. The first thing in doesn't have any particular customs. Oh, wait a minute. It says battery charger module. Okay. Let's just see if that's what it really is. Ooh, it's several. It's a whole bunch. Okay. Looks like 10 of them. So these look like they are a lithium ion, probably battery charger. It's got a voltage output over here with an adjustment. That's interesting. Some sort of little power supply module. Let's check the listing and see exactly what it is. 10 pieces lithium ion 18650 3.7 to 4.2 volt battery charger board DC to DC step up boost module. I got 10 of these for $5.30 plus $2.35 shipping. So that's still well under a dollar a piece, which is a pretty good deal. So the input voltage can be anywhere from 4.5 to 8 volts. All right. The output voltage, it's boosted and can be all the way up to 27 volts if you want. Wow. 1 amp charging current, 2 amps discharging current on the 18650. Well, that's a clever little board. I think that might come in handy. Okay, let's try this here. I've got just a random 18650 plugged in. It is, what has it got right now? Ooh, it's almost dead. It's only got 2.4 volts on it. So let's see what the output looks like here. Ooh, there's 5 volts. Okay. Can we adjust it? That's going down. Okay. Oh, wow. Look at that. 13, 18, 27 volts. Wow. Out of an almost dead 18650. So let's see what happens when you plug the charge side in. It said it could charge it up to 1 amp. So this should work. Or it'll blow up. What's happening now? There we got 4 volts on there. So it's charging. And oh yeah, there's a little LED come on there. Cool. And there's another LED beside it. I'm assuming that is indicating that the charging is done. I think that could come in right properly handy. Next thing in, it says thread gauge. Okay. It's all covered in oil. So this is interesting. Okay, I remember. This is a thread pitch gauge. It lets you know how many threads to the inch or threads to the centimeter a bolt is. And I'm not sure if this is a metric one or an imperial one. But I do know I have to wipe some of this oil off it. Not all of it, because I don't want it to get rusty, but definitely some of it. 55/60 degree metric inch thread plug gauge gear tooth screw pitch gauges. I got this at auction for the princely sum of $1.60 Canadian with free shipping, which is one of the main reasons why I bought it. It's not something that I need because I don't do an awful lot of mechanical stuff or thread forming or anything like that. But for $1.50, I figured that'd be reasonable to get. So it claims to be a 60 degree thread metric pitch and 55 degree thread inch pitch. So it says for metric, it ranges from 0.4 threads per millimeter, I guess, up to 6 threads per millimeter. And in the imperial 55 degree pitch, it goes all the way from 4 threads per inch up to 48 threads per inch. However, what I got here, and the only thing in the package, says 55 degrees, which is the imperial one. And that checks out because it goes all the way from 4 up to, 48. There it is. So what you use this for, if you've got an unknown bolt or something and you're trying to order the replacement or the nut to go with it or more bolts or whatever, use this gauge and just test it until you find out what the pitch is. Now this I happen to know is a 1/4 inch 20 bolt, which is the standard camera mount, and you see that fits perfectly on there just like that. If you tried one of the other ones, it just wouldn't mesh, so we know that that is in fact 20 threads per inch. Here's another one that I just happen to have memorized. The standard screw for putting a light switch or a plug socket into a box is a 6/32, and we can verify that with a 32. That's not all that useful when you know what it is, but it is useful when you've got a screw that you're not quite sure what it is. So for, what was that, $1.60? It's still worthwhile. If I was a machinist or something like that, this would be super duper useful, but I don't do any of that kind of things. Although I do have some taps for tapping threads, so that could still come in handy. Although I was kind of hoping there was a metric one came with this, like the listing said. Right, well, let's see what else we got. This one says 2 momentary push switch buttons. That's possible, I suppose. It's 4. Oh, and there's 2 different kinds. Okay, hang on here. Okay, so I got 2 different kinds of switches and 2 each. So these ones are just a single pole momentary switch. Push on, release off. And these ones are a, what is it, a 3-pole double throw. And they are a latching switch. So those are typically used in foot switches or stomp switches, like a guitar pedal foot switch or something like that. And I think I ordered these to maybe make a remote controller for that that pod guitar pedal that I got at a thrift store a while ago. Remember, I'll put a link to it up there if you don't remember seeing that. It has provision for a foot switch of its own design or of its own proprietary brand, but it also has MIDI inputs. So I was thinking I might use these for that. 1-piece 3P DT 9-pin guitar effect stomp switch pedal box foot pedal metal tar switch. Right. I bought 2 of these. Currently they're selling for $334 American or $427 Canadian. And from the same seller, SPST momentary soft touch push button stomp foot switch pedal electric guitar switch. Yeah, same seller. These ones are $324 or $414 Canadian. And again, with shipping, but I bought 2 each and I bought them all together to save on shipping, which seems to be the only way to get any kind of a deal these days. Not much to say about them down here. Max current 5 amps, working current 2 amps. What about this one? It's probably not intending as much current through it. Yeah, it doesn't say. So this one is definitely going to be for a small signal. The other one, it looks like you can pull some current through it, though. Although I don't think you'd want to use it for AC line voltage. Maybe to control a relay to power something like, a spot welder or something like that. That might be interesting. Or just low signal like I was intending. Next, we have ADC 0809 module AD converter 8-channel parallel. That's very precise. I'm guessing that's probably what it really is. So we have a module with some standoff feet here. We have some pins on this side, which are N0 to N7. And then on this side, D0 to D7. Down here, what do we have? These look like address pins. We have 5 volts and ground, clock, DE, EOC, and ST. Little jumper and a pot. And the chip is, don't even need a magnifying glass. The chip is an ADC 0809 CCN. So from the name on the outside of the bag, I thought it was an analog to digital converter, but maybe it isn't. I can't remember what this is. Yeah, I know. Oh, this guy doesn't know what he ordered. I ordered this months ago. It's been sitting in the in international shipping and then in my inbox until today. I'm sure I'll remember it once I see the listing. ADC 0809 module, analog to digital converter, 8-channel parallel digital voltmeter module. Got this for $7.79 Canadian with free shipping from Lost Goods 88. Now then, I must have been a little bit confused when I ordered this, because it's not exactly what I thought it was. So it has, as the name implies, an 8 input channels for the analog to digital converter, but it's an 8-bit resolution, which is, yes, fairly low for a modern piece of equipment, but it isn't a modern piece of equipment. Its range is 0 to plus 5 volts. You can, of course, use external resistive dividers to knock that down if you're measuring something higher. And then we have that A, B, and C address inputs. That just selects in binary which of the 8 inputs we're measuring at this given time. So you could control that with a microcontroller or something to choose which of your 8 analog inputs you're measuring on the left-hand side there. The other thing that confused me a little bit is these D0 through D7 outputs on the right-hand side. And that's where I got a little bit confused when I was ordering this thing. I thought it was something else, but it should be fun to play with anyway. Let me show you what that is. So here is the main chip, and you can see there's stuff copy and pasted straight out of here into the description, which doesn't really surprise me. But there's the block diagram. So you have your 8 analog channels coming in here. There's your address thingy. And there's the internal comparator, which is checking this voltage against this resistor ladder and its tree of switches. And it puts the output on these 8 bits as a representation of the voltage. And here is sort of the heart of the thing. There's the resistor ladder. It has 256 resistors in a massive voltage divider there, and it just steps these switches one at a time based on the clocking of the thing, putting a voltage from the reference voltage out to the comparator and comparing that against the incoming voltage. So how this thing was originally intended to work back in the day was that it would dump its 8-bit output onto a data bus of a microprocessor or microcontroller type thing. I suppose we could still do that, couldn't we? Although it's going to chew up a lot of digital pins. But if you're on a microcontroller that has tons of digital pins but no analog pins, this might be a solution if you needed to read a handful of analog signals. I don't know. Maybe I just wasted some money, but it might be interesting to play with nonetheless. This one says electronic components, which is perfectly accurate and perfectly mysterious. Oh, looks like it's... Oh, hey, that looks like a kit. Man, I was hoping this would show up before Christmas so that I could do it during my December kit-o-rama. So we have 5 7-segment LEDs. We have a fairly thick circuit board here. A whole bunch of resistors of the same value, which are no doubt for that. Transistor, crystal, another transistor, handful of capacitors. Oh, a variable capacitor. You don't see those very often in a kit. A little power jack. Socket and an IC. What are you? You are a PIC microcontroller, a PIC 16F628A. Don't know much about PIC. Doesn't matter, I don't have to program it. Has anybody guessed what this kit is, or do we have to look at the label on the board? It is a frequency counter / crystal tester kit. This is one that I don't see very often, and it could be interesting to play with. I don't really see the need to test crystals. They don't fail very often. And if they do, it's usually because they've been mechanically abused. So an interesting little kit to put together. Fairly straightforward. And it might actually have some uses, especially as a frequency counter. A few of the newer meters, multimeters, are frequency counters, as you know, but it doesn't hurt to have a dedicated one. I will put that together at some point in the future. That is a neat little kit. 1 Hz, the 50 MHz crystal oscillator tester and frequency counter DIY kits meter with case, or without, as I bought it. I got this from Survey 2014, which is a fairly familiar name. I bought a fair number of things from that guy over the years. This one currently costs $7.65 Canadian with $2.53 shipping. What are they talking about with case? Ah, there's a yellow version that actually comes with a case, which is a few dollars more, but me being a cheapskate, or, you know, trying to stretch my Patreon's money as far as it'll go, I've got the one without the case. I got a 3D printer. If I want a case, I can make my own. So what does it say here? It's PIC microcontroller-based frequency meter. Subtraction frequency is set with crystal measurement functions and programmable. 5-digit display, easy and intuitive. It can measure from 1 hertz to 50 megahertz. It goes into power saving within 15 seconds. Okay. The description looks like it's been copy-pasted straight out of some manual, so I'm going to have to go hunting when I build this thing to see if I can find that manual, just to understand a little bit more about what's going on inside it. But I think we should be fairly straightforward anyway, because the PIC is doing all the heavy lifting in software.
And there is the contents of today's Mailbag Monday haul. Yet another interesting and varied one. Let's quickly go over the shipping times. The crystal tester kit took only 18 days. Wow. This greasy little thread pitch gauge took 22 days. This analog to digital converter took 20 days. These 10 little charger and boost boards took 21 days. And coming in at the end of the train is these little foot switches, which took 46 whole days to get here from China. Wow. And actually, most of these things, even though the sellers claim to be Chinese, I think three of them came from the UK, one of them came from the Arab Emirates, and one of them actually did come from Hong Kong. So, yeah, I don't know what's going on with it. Global shipping these days, I don't think anybody does. Anyway, yeah, these should be fun to play with in due course. This thing is already doing some work, charging up 18650 that I had kicking around here. Not sure when I'm going to build that kit. Should I do it sooner or should I save it for later in the year? I'm not sure yet. Are you kitted out? Yeah, this project could be interesting too. I'm not sure which ones I'm going to use, or maybe I'll use both of them. And at some point, I suppose I should sit down and play with this thing and just make it get up and dance and do its job a little bit. I don't know. We shall see. Anyway, thanks for watching. Appreciate that as always. Thanks to my Patreon supporters and my YouTube channel members for helping support this madness, keeping the beer fridge full and keeping the mailbags rolling in. Questions and comments down below as usual. I guess that's everything for tonight. Thanks for watching. I'll talk to you later.